And I would request the Honorable Consul General to please give his concluding remarks.
First of all, sorry, because of a very important appointment in Colaba, I couldn't cover the whole session, just one or two sessions I covered. But the last session is quite inspiring, impressive for me. Came to my mind that in 19th century, 1853 is a quite important epoch-making year for Japan, because first steamboat made by IM came from United States and visited Japan. For the first time, the people in Japan had a chance to watch on the modern steam engine a merchant ship we call Black Ship, Kurofune. This is a kind of a game changer for the starting of the modernization of Japan. But at the same time, 1853, the first commuting train were operated in Mumbai. So the train system started in Mumbai faster than in Japan. Then, because of the kind of the rhetoric of history, my country now is a pride for the train system, and asking a collaboration with India to support our system introduction to the new, as a new modernized train system. However, you have a good experience, good memory about modern train technology. I know that outside of so-called Western powers, only three Asia African countries can assemble the very high-tech train at that time called locomotive trains, dissolving and maintain and assemble again that such very complicated train locomotive system train. One is Japan, second is South Africa, then third was India. So you have a knowledge, know-how, how to make a high-tech train. So we have no hesitation say that sooner or later you become, implement the entire new train network system in entire India. Besides all that, metro issues, this is also the quite important system. Even though we can shorten the time between Ahmedabad to Mumbai in 2.5 hours, the connection to the urban development system, urban transportation system cannot be constructed well. That is still a waste of time. So hope the Mumbai, city of Mumbai, and the state of Maharashtra think more seriously the introduction of the public transportation system, new transportation system. Anyway, this is a good opportunity for us to exchange the views and questions, and I found several weak points of my country. So I'm very much satisfied with this debate. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Consul General. I entirely endorse and reiterate what Consul General Ito said at the end, that this has been a highly satisfying conference. Satisfying because it was highly educative. I'm sure all of you will agree with me that we go back with a lot of learnings about India-Japan partnership, learnings about Japan, and also learnings about our own country and, to some extent, our own city. We covered wide-ranging issues in this one day, beginning with economic cooperation, peace and prosperity in Asia, Asia-Pacific, and very rightly pointed out by the speakers in the second session that it's not Ambassador Alok Prasadji, that not Asia-Pacific, Indo-Pacific. The third session, cultural, creative, artistic, and spiritual commons. And then we had infrastructure and smart cities. So I want to thank all the speakers, all the distinguished speakers. We would have liked to listen to them longer period, especially, you know, when Admiral Chauhan was speaking, we felt deprived the opportunity of learning from his very deep knowledge. Same with Ambassador Rangachari. He simply had to skip so many of his well-researched slides. Nevertheless, each of the speakers has added to our understanding of India-Japan partnership. And on behalf of the Observer Research Foundation, and on your behalf, friends, let's give them a big hand. One of the reasons we decided to partner with the Japanese consulate here on organizing this conference is because the Observer Research Foundation, Mumbai, is deeply committed to regaining, restoring Bombay's global outlook. You know, we must once again make this great city a truly global city with a global outlook, with global networks, something that over the past several decades has got weakened. Ambassador Aftab Seth mentioned that the Japanese consulate was established here 1896, even before it was established in the then capital of India, Calcutta. And I've heard, and I hope I'm not making a mistake in this, but I heard that before the Second World War, the Japanese population in Mumbai was close to some 2,000. It has dwindled precipitously. We must make Mumbai a global city with a very broad spectrum of global population, a city that is vibrant in terms of discussing global issues and making its own contribution to the big issues of the day as far as the world is concerned. And this is one of the reasons, friends, that ORF Mumbai has been trying to partner with consulates in Mumbai, embassies in Delhi, and other international organizations in organizing events like these. And we are very happy that this one has turned out to be extremely satisfying. Ambassador Seth mentioned that he went to Japan more than 50 years ago. And while we were, you know, in the course of the conference, he quietly sent his book to me. It's Half a Century, My Connections with Japan, a Memoir. And he wrote something, friends, and I would like to read out just one passage here. He wrote this in June 1963, and it's so valid. Friendship in Japan is like Japanese food. In the same way as it is difficult to determine the taste of a piece of ikka in the beginning, it is difficult to ascertain the strength of a Japanese friendship in the beginning. But slowly, as one eats more sushi, one begins to appreciate its taste. A Japanese friendship too grows in value with the passage of time. It is this subtlety which I found very noticeable in Japan, in the food, the climate, and the friendships. There is none of the open, gushing kind of friendship that one finds in India. You know, Japanese are very unique people. There is none of the open, gushing kind of friendship that one finds in India. I'm not quite certain which form of friendship I prefer, but I certainly value my Japanese friends as one of the most precious things in my life. This is what Aftab Seth Ji said, wrote in 1963. So friendship with Japan, it doesn't come quickly, because friendships that come very quickly can also dissipate quickly. You know, as was mentioned in one of the earlier sessions, you know, the Japanese are, they take their own time to make friendships. But once they make a decision, once they make a friendship, then it is almost unbreakable. They take a, you know, it is said by some of the people, oh, they are, there's too much delay in decision making, they are too consensus bound. But some of these qualities are also highly valuable. There is a great level of ethics in Japanese businesses. And of course, their concern for the environment and all that. So we have to first of all appreciate the uniqueness of Japan. And I think that today's conference enabled us, helped us to understand so many things that are truly unique and so admirable. The fact that in becoming a prosperous nation, the third prosperous nation in terms of, you know, dollar economy, it still has the third highest forest cover, you know, as was pointed out by Ajit Ranade. Now, forests, great heritage of nature, they have preserved it. That is also wealth. Similarly, culture. You know, we spend so much time talking about smart cities. But one of the ladies here asked a question about what is the place for culture in this whole smart city conceptualization and planning and development? Very pertinent question. Culture. You know, lunchtime, Alok Prasad Ji, he said something about the culture of Japan, of which resilience, the collective spirit, is the core. 1945, the country was devastated. But 1964, in less than two decades, Japan organized, Japan hosted the Olympics. In less than 20 years, they had Shinkansen. They had rebuilt the airport, one of the most modern airports in the world. And as the Consul General pointed out, railways was born in India much earlier, but today we are seeking Japanese cooperation in high-speed rail technology. But it's not just these physical aspects that constitute culture. You know, when this horrible tragedy struck Japan in 2011, the triple tragedy of earthquakes, tsunami, and the nuclear meltdown. You know, we had organized, as I mentioned, we had organized the talk by the former Japanese ambassador, Mr. Saiki. And we had put up one poster, friends, which of course we had taken from the net. And it is there in the document that we have circulated to you. It says 10 things to learn from Japan. And this goes to the heart of the unique culture of Japan that we need to learn from. One, the calm. Not a single, when this tragedy happened, when this natural calamity happened, not a single visual of chest beating, wild grief, sorrow itself has been elevated. The second quality, the dignity, disciplined queues for water and groceries, not a rough word or a crude gesture. The third quality, the ability, the incredible architecture. For instance, building swayed but did not fall. You know, Japan is a place that very frequently experiences earthquakes. So they have found that the technology, the architecture to take care of these things. The grace, people bought only what they needed for the present, so everybody could get something. Five, the order. No looting in shops, no honking, and no overtaking on the roads, just understanding. Six, the sacrifice. 50 workers stayed back to pump seawater in the nuclear reactors. How will they ever be repaid? You know, it was mentioned that none other than the emperor and the empress, they visited the place within days of what happened. So it is the leadership that shows the way. Seven, the tenderness. Restaurants cut prices. An unguarded ATM is left alone. The strong cared for the weak. Eight, the training. The old and the children, everyone knew exactly what to do. And they did just that, to take care of the old and the children. The media, they showed magnificent restraint in the bulletins. No silly reporting, only calm and restrained reporting. Lastly, the conscience. When the power went off in a store, people put things back on the shelves and left quietly. This is culture. It does not come with whether a country is rich or poor. Culture is formed over a period of hundreds of years, thousands of years. And in the course of the conference, I really felt that our session on culture and spiritual traditions, it really lent a very, it imparted a unique understanding to what Japan is. And that, for that, we should really thank Jaya Jetli ji. We should thank Abha. We should thank the monk from the Japanese temple in Worli. Someone who has been living here for decades. And I don't know how many of you have visited the temple. Every time I visit the temple, it's on one of the most busiest roads in Bombay. Once you are inside the temple, all you experience is peace and tranquility. That goes to show spirit of a place, you know, a phrase that Abha used in her presentation. Spirit of a place, and that spirit of a place really extends to the whole nation of Japan. There is something about the spirit of the Japanese people, which in spite of all adversities, they have retained. And that is what we need to learn. So what Alok Prasadji said at the end of his speech, the strongest ace that Japan has is people. And therefore, the strongest ace that even India has is our people. We must revive our culture.
our spiritual traditions, our artistic traditions, this is our intangible wealth, far more precious than the physical wealth that we are creating. The physical wealth, of course, is important, but it is far more precious that we have inherited from the past, our culture, our spiritualism, our artistic traditions. So we have, I would say, a certain holistic understanding of India-Japan partnership in the course of this conference. I would like to say one more thing, friends, in the session on peace and security. There was some discussion on India-Japan and, of course, China. And China has to figure, because China has become important in Asia and in the world, and China is our neighbor. We cannot wish away China. We at the Observer Research Foundation, you know, we have been making our own small efforts to promote better understanding between India and China. And we believe that India, Japan, China, we have to work together. There are issues between China and Japan, and we fervently wish that these issues are resolved peacefully, because once again, the cultural and spiritual and civilizational ties, linguistic ties between Japan and China, they are far more important than the present disputes. And we really hope that the wisdom of Chinese people and the wisdom of the Japanese people will help them overcome the problems that have cropped up in recent times. And India, the land of Buddha, Buddha's philosophy that traveled from India to China and from China to Japan, we have to remain true to the principles and the philosophy of Buddha. We have to remain true to our commitment to world peace, to peace in Asia, and not commit the mistakes that the West committed. So I felt that I should reiterate this point in the concluding session. I'm very happy, friends, that we have partnered with the consulate, and this partnership we would very much like to continue and get strengthened. I want to thank the audience, even though the conference is extended well beyond the stipulated time. You all have been here listening patiently, participating very passionately. So we want to thank you. Without you, this conference wouldn't have been a success. Thank you very much. Dhanyawad.
Yeah, this is a small announcement that in about 15 to 20 minutes, maybe half an hour, we'll have the dinner served right outside. So thank you all for coming. Thank you, all our speakers. You have really made this day special for us. And so, with your permission, we can bring this conference to a close. Thank you very much.